Hello and welcome to Down the Scope. Today we're going to be looking at a slide showing serial transverse sections of a lancelet, also known as Amphioxus or reasonably classified as a branchiostoma. Further up the phylogeny, they are chordates, so they're in the same phylum as humans and other vertebrates, but unlike us they don't have a vertebral column. But of course chordates are not defined as the presence of a vertebral column, as vertebrates are. Instead, chordates are classified based on the presence of four features: a notochord, a dorsal nerve cord, pharyngeal slits, and a post-anal tail. And just like the lancelet, you would have had these same features, but during your embryonic development. Rather than retaining these features into adulthood, your notochord became your intervertebral discs, while your dorsal nerve cord became your spinal cord. The pharyngeal slits formed your face, jaw and ears, and your post-anal tail shrunk down to form your coccyx. But this homology between ourselves and these rather primitive animals, the lancelet, means that they've become a very important model for us to study our own development and to give us clues as to how our own organs evolved and developed. One thing we can do is have a look at how lancelets fit in on the tree of life. So this is a website that I use quite often, and I thoroughly recommend it, called onezoom.org. And it provides an interactive, zoomable tree of life, all the way from bacteria down to the eukaryotes down here on this tiny branch over here. So if we search for lancelets, it will take us to their position on the tree. So here they are on the tree of life. As you can see, they're part of the chordates, which began to develop about 540 million years ago. And it's thought that lancelets are quite similar to ancient chordates that evolved at this time due to their anatomic similarity to fossils, for example, in the Burgess Shale. So they could be defined as living fossils. Further along the tree of life, we eventually get to the vertebrates, which is when we start to see the development of a vertebral column, beginning with the jawless vertebrates and then coming into the jawed vertebrates, such as fish, reptiles, amphibians, birds, and mammals. So if we have a look at what a lancelet looks like in real life, they look quite fish-like, but if you look closely, they're really very different. You'll notice that they don't have any bones, no vertebral column at all. They don't really have any head structure. So this is the head here. There are no eyes. The only brain-like structure is a slight swelling of the dorsal nerve cord. They do have mouth parts, which are these bits here. And they seem to have quite a simple body structure. You can just about see the muscle segments here. But apart from that, they're fairly unremarkable externally. So the slide that we're going to look at is transverse sections, which means that we have a section perhaps here, and then another one here. And then they're taking serial sections all the way down. So we'll miss out on the structures of the head, but we'll get a good, nice look at the organs and how they flow through the body of the lancelet. Of course, I'm no expert on lancelets, so I've been using different sources to learn about their biology and anatomy. So the main source that I've used is an essay written on this web page called biologydiscussion.com. It has some lovely figures. You can go and check it out yourself. It has some background information on the biology of lancelets. Basically, they are sea-dwelling animals that live buried in the mud with their heads emerging, and there they use their mouthparts to filter food from the surrounding seawater. So this is quite a nice diagram showing the internal anatomy, and maybe we can use this to start to identify which of our sections are cranial, which of them are caudal, and what structures we might be able to see. So as I mentioned before, we're probably going to miss out on all of these mouth parts here, which are the apparatus to get water flowing into the digestive system. But we'll probably get the nerve cord up here at the top, and then underneath there'll be the notochord. We'll probably see some of the pharynx as well, with its gill slits, and we'll come onto those maybe in another video. Depending on where the section's cut, we might get some esophagus that the gastrointestinal tract comes back through, develops into an esophagus, and then into the gut. If we have a look now at this diagram, which focuses more on the digestive system of the lancelet, we'll probably get some sections with this organ called the hepatic diverticulum. We'll have some sections with midgut, and then we'll have some sections with hindgut as well. If we go back to our slide, we can maybe start to pick out some of these features. So this looks like a more cranial section, so more towards the head. This structure here is going to be the pharynx. We can see the gill slits here. And then this, just to the side of it, will be the hepatic diverticulum. You remember that in the diagram that we saw earlier, the hepatic diverticulum was running just along next to the pharynx. Here, these look like ovaries, so these will be the gonads. And then we've got layers of muscle over here. So I have made some annotations. The pharynx here in yellow. Let's see if I can remember how to fill. There we go. The ovaries in purple, and the midgut or the hepatic diverticulum in green. Now the notochord and the nerve cord are over here, but they're not so good in this section. You'll see that the notochord has folded over a bit. That's an artifact of when they were floating the section onto the slide. Because the sections are so thin, they can fold in on themselves. So I've made some more annotations for maybe a later video. Okay. So here, this is also a cranial section, but perhaps it's a little further back. The hepatic diverticulum is a little bit wider, and that's the only clue really as to that it's from more caudally. Perhaps this is the start of the esophagus here, and we have a much nicer section of the notochord. So if we zoom in, this is the notochord. And then just above the notochord, we've got this rather faint structure here. I wonder if we can reduce the staining or change the staining a bit. And perhaps that's a little better. This structure here is the dorsal nerve cord, and we can see some neurons here that are signaling that, and then this looks to be like a nerve coming off from it. But we can discuss that and the nervous system of the branchiostomes perhaps in a later video. Okay, so coming backwards then, this section is from more caudally. We've lost the pharynx and it's been completely replaced by this structure, which looks very similar to the hepatic diverticulum, but it's much larger. So this will probably be the midgut. We've still got ovaries here and some muscle, the dorsal nerve cord and the notal cord. And then finally, in these sections, in the fourth column, we've now lost our gonads, there's no ovaries, but we still have some kind of gut structure along with notochord and nerve cord and dorsal nerve cord. So this is going to be one of the more caudal sections, and this might be a bit of the hind gut. So I think for the rest of this video we'll just go over perhaps some of the external structures that we can see in these sections here. And maybe the muscle, and we'll leave the reproductive and gastrointestinal and nervous tract for a separate video. So if we zoom in, as I mentioned, or I may not have mentioned, the staining in this slide is quite faint. It's faded over time, so this is quite an old slide. So if we dash back now to our guide on the anatomy of branchiostomes or lancelets, we can start to use it to identify some of the structures that we can see on the slide. So lancelets have an epidermis formed of a layer of single cells, and we can see them here. They have quite distinct cell borders. So if we zoom in, we can see, just make out the nucleus here, and then the cell membranes between each of them. I can turn on cell detection in this program, and it'll highlight the nucleus here in the darker red, and then each of the individual cells that it's decided it's going to pick out. So now if we switch the view to another area of the slide, we can see that below the epidermal cells there's a very thin layer, maybe about 7 micrometers thick, just below the epidermal cells. If we refer back to our diagram of the skin, this is called the cutis, which means that the tissue below it must be called the subcutis, because it's underneath the cutis. So the subcutis will refer to all of this connective tissue under here. From the tip of this blue line to the other end. The function of the subcutis is going to be to carry blood vessels and nerve fibers. The nerve fibers will likely be sensory, so they'll be detecting things like touch or maybe light or chemicals, what have you. The blood vessels will serve to oxygenate and provide an oxygen supply. So the pharyngeal slits in the lancelets they don't have any respiratory function. Instead, like in the earthworm, the lancelet relies on blood vessels passing close to the skin in order to pick up oxygen and transport it to the rest of the body. So now, within the subcutis, we can start to see these kind of thin circles. I highlighted a few here. These are probably blood vessels. They don't have any blood cells in them, so they're quite hard to identify. Often in other higher organisms, you'd be able to identify blood vessels by blood cells, or in the worm slides, they were filled with kind of a pinky fluid, but that's not stained in these sections. So we have to rely on their outlines to be able to identify them. So there's quite a lot you can see here, blood vessels within the subcutis. Nerve cells would be extremely challenging to find. They've probably not stained particularly well on this section, but congratulations to anyone who thinks that they can find something on these slides that looks like a nerve cell. So then below the skin, below the subcutis, we'll reach the muscle layer. So this here looks like a bit of muscle to me. It looks like muscle to me because it's in long fibers, and you can just about make out the striations in it. So these alternating bands of dark and light, which are where the actin and myosin, presumably, I'm not sure if they have the same proteins in branchiostomes compared to higher organisms, where those contractile proteins overlap or don't. So there's a nice band of muscle going there along, along the bottom of the branchiostome. So most of the muscle is up here, and this is the muscle that's going to be used for movement. So I think we can stop there. There's plenty more to discuss on this slide because we've got the gastrointestinal system, including the pharynx and the hepatic diverticulum, which are very interesting in terms of development and kind of homology between the lancelets and ourselves. And then we have the gonads as well, which are perhaps not as interesting in that respect, but they're quite pretty. So thank you very much for watching this video. If you want to go and check out the slide, it's available on the website. The link is in the description below. And you can have a go at looking at the features that we've described, maybe going ahead and having a look at the other organs that we can see on the slide. So until next time, thank you very much for listening and goodbye.